the blank spots. If there's nothing further at this time, we'll have our first prayer, then we'll have our singing.
Let us pray together. Most gracious Heavenly Father, as we bow in thy presence, Father, we do so humbly and reverently, acknowledging you as our God and realizing, Father, our dependency upon you each day of our life. We're thankful for all of thy blessings, and we pray, dear God, that we would use thy blessings in a way that would be pleasing to you. We ask you, dear God, at this time to be especially mindful of Brother Lossie, Sister Kathy, and Brenda, and all of those, Father, that Tony mentioned in the announcements. You know their cares, you know their wants and their needs, and you pray, Father, that you would care for them as you alone can do. We're thankful yet, Father, for another opportunity to gather in thy presence to worship you in truth and in spirit. We pray that we would leave the thoughts and the cares of this world outside at this time, and let all of our attention, Father, be directed to you and to thy word that guides us each day of our life. We ask you, dear God, to forgive us of our sin. We know we fall short of thy glory. We repent. We ask thy forgiveness. Be with Brother Roger as he speaks unto us the word of life. We may take it into our heart. We may take it into our life. And we may share it, Father, with others. Help each of us, Father, as we labor in this congregation, that we might speak thy word, and we might do so in a way that others would accept it and obey thy truth. Be with each of us, Father. Strengthen us physically, strengthen us spiritually, as we humbly walk in the truth of thy word. Be with us now, guide us and direct us. Humbly we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Number 800.
Thy tall, sweet dreams over land and sea, bidding us look to realms above. While the light from the throne shines for you and me, lifts us to the call of love. Thy call is ringing, coming from the throne above.
Strength
805.
I come to the garden of love, the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me. And he tells me I am his home, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
He speaks and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing,
and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry.
After this song, Brother Roger will bring our lesson 234.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as my onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane that I have found, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay, though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till then I'm found, Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, by faith on heaven's table land,
Number 781 will be our song of invitation. 781.
Thinking about some of you all that have been around for a little while, and how many remember that song we just sang from many years ago? I can remember singing that when I was growing up in Lord's Church in Chattanooga. It always made me think about a train for some reason, just the words of the song. But we are pressing on. Turn your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3, beginning with about verse 12, will be our primary text for the next few minutes, or base text for our lesson today. I want to ask the question before we begin the lesson is, what are your goals, or what is your number one goal in life? I learned some years back, if a person does not set goals, they will not attain any. And that sounds kind of trite, but it's true. If you don't plan for something, you'll never do it. Paul was one of those people whose plan was to go to heaven and see the Lord. In the meantime, he had to live on this earth just like the rest of us. So he's writing to the Christians in Colossae. In Colossians 3 at verse 12, Paul would say, "So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another, forgiving one another, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also you should do. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful." When I think about what Paul is telling us in these words here, that having some kind of goal for the future, when he says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another, in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your heart to the Lord." That goes on through verse 16. When I read these words, I cannot help but think about Paul, that he's telling us and how we should be living our lives for the Lord. And I really meant to read verses 2 and following. Somehow my computer mistyped what I intended to use. In Colossians 3, beginning with verse 1. "Therefore, if you have been raised with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory." So pardon my first reading there. I just put down the right words, the right text, but I typed it wrong. Our goal. Sometimes our goal is to make sure we're not late for Sunday school. Sometimes our goal is, did I get my Bible to go to church today? Am I going to make it for worship if I don't make it to Sunday school? I hope I can get back on Wednesday night and don't have to work too late. Those are worthy goals, aren't they? But in reality, our goal should be seeking always those things that are above. Things that are outside and beyond and above this world and are eternal in nature. We have the tendency to be earthly-minded people. And I'm not talking necessarily about a vulgar mind or an ungodly mind, but an earthly mindset that what's going on here and now. And I know I say this often, but the older I get, the more I realize that we're just one heartbeat away from seeing the face of the Lord. Just one heartbeat away. So I raised the question, what are our goals in life, our upward goal? According to Colossians 3, 1 through 4, it should be setting our mind on those things that are above and not on the things that are on the earth. That takes an effort on my part to think about the eternal. And all too often, the worldly, the day-to-day activities call for my attention. And sometimes they don't just do it very loudly. Sometimes they're just there and I give them my attention. And sometimes the call from those things is very loud. We understand. But one of the things that I love about assembling with God's people for Bible study and the period here of worship this morning is being reminded that there is something beyond this world. There is something beyond this world called eternal life. It's called eternity. You know, Peter would tell us that there was a price paid that helped us become children of God. In 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning with verse 17, he says, if you address the Father, the one who impartially judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves in fear during the time of your stay on earth, knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of a lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. When we stop to think of the price that was paid for us to be forgiven of our sins, the spotless lamb that was an antitype of that lamb slain under the law of Moses as a sacrifice for sin. I don't care how much money a person has. I don't care how much education a person has, or how much intelligence a person has, or if they have reached some of their earthly goals in life. No matter what we have in this world, nothing compares with the price that was paid for our sins. Nothing. Somebody says, well, when I retire, I'm going to get this amount of money. Or every year I work and this company gives me a bonus. Well, good. I think that's great. But there's a bigger bonus than that.
Amen.
The price that was paid for our sins. I think about people today in some parts of our world who may not eat today or not eat very much. But they have Christ in their lives, and they understand this upward call far better sometimes than some others. Consider the price that was paid. Consider the steps that we are to follow in 1 Peter 2 and verse 21. Paul says, for you've been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. It's one thing for me to read about a suffering Savior. It's one thing for me to read about the crucifixion of Christ and see how he was treated and how awful crucifixion was. But Jesus' suffering did not begin on Calvary. Jesus gave up everything. When you read the fourth chapter of Paul's letter to the church of Philippi, he emptied himself. He divested himself of all the benefits that he could have had in heaven, and he came to earth. And his life was one of sacrifice from the very beginning all the way to the end. And you have this mindset in you, you've been called for this rather, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example. We are selfish people by nature, aren't we? We are, let's just be honest. Elisa and I were talking about it that on the way up here. We have to work at not being selfish and self-centered. Jesus was the most selfless person who ever lived. He had an upward call. But the first thing he wanted to do is to make sure all the world had the opportunity to know about it. The opportunity to know that there is a heaven. He said, I'm going away to prepare a place for you in John 14. And I'll come again and receive you to myself. But in between that time, from that time and then when he comes back, he had to die and he suffered. The blood of Jesus was paid. But Jesus had an upward goal. We need the mind that Jesus had. Turn with me in your Bibles to the second chapter of Philippians in the fourth verse. Paul says, have this attitude, the New American Standard says, or mind, other translations.
Have this mind or attitude in yourselves, which was in Christ Jesus. Although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. Jesus, when he began his ministry, he took on the form of a bondservant. We don't know anything about his early years. The only thing we know about is his birth, and then that when he was about 12 years old, he goes into the temple, and his parents are looking for him, and they find him, and he says, "Do you not know that I must be about my father's things or my father's business?" But from that time on until about 30, we know nothing. But we do know that when he began his ministry, there was nothing that Jesus wouldn't sacrifice for the benefit of others like us. But how did he do that? He had a mindset. He had an attitude in himself. And the Bible says even though he existed in the form of God, he did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped or held on to. Jesus did not divest himself of deity, but he divested himself of the benefits. He lived like a pauper according to our standards. From what we read about the life of Jesus, it seemed that the only thing he owned were the clothes on his back. But he survived. He was a sacrificial Savior. I do not believe the Lord expects us to live that kind of lifestyle. But he does expect us to live a sacrificial lifestyle. If we're going to look above, we need to look about and see, is there some place where I can be used and serve my Lord? The second thing we want to do, other than living a Christ-like life, the first one is living a Christ-like life. The second one is living by faith and not by sight, 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 7. It's easy to live by what you see. You remember Thomas, he would not believe unless he could touch Jesus. I think Jesus gave him a gentle rebuke for that. But he said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." And so, there were those who heard the testimony of those who saw the risen Lord and they believed it. And there are people today, we believe that he was risen. We have the written testimony. He's never spoken to us, at least not except in Scripture. But God has never sat down next to me and said, "Hey, I created the world." No, he tells us in Romans 1 verse 20, if I look at it, I can know. I can see the evidence of God's power. Walking by faith and not by sight. The difference in the creationist and the evolutionist is the creationist believes it even though he didn't see God do it because it's here. And I think, well, that's a great thing. I doubt there are any evolutionists or atheists in this room. I hope there aren't any listening today. If they are, I want you to consider the fact that God did not have to explain anything that he's not already explained in Scripture. In the beginning, God. Did I see it? No, but I see the results. I know something is here. But living by faith and not by sight. The Bible talks about weak faith. The Bible talks about little faith. The Bible talks about great faith. The Bible talks about much faith and strong faith. There are different levels and different kinds of faith. Then we read about a saving faith. Turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 4. Beginning, with about verse 16. Paul is contrasting the law with Abraham and the promise made to him in verse 13. Verse 16, Paul would say in Romans 4, "For this reason it is by faith, in order that it may be in accordance with grace, so that the promise will be guaranteed to all the descendants, not only those who are of the law," talking about Jews, "but also those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written," verse 17, "a father of many nations have I made you in the presence of him whom he believed, even God, who gives life to the dead and calls into being that which does not exist. In hope against hope, Abraham believed so that he might become the father of many nations according to that which had been spoken. So shall your descendants be." Now listen to Paul. Here's a man who's Paul is getting ready to say that is as good as dead, But God has promised him that he would have a child his old age. Sarah, whose womb was dead. Listen to verse 19. Without becoming weak in faith, Abraham struggled one or two times, but for the most part, he was not weak in faith. He was not, and he contemplated his own body. Hey, I'm nearly 100 years old. And then the deadness of Sarah's womb. People that age do not conceive and have children. It just doesn't happen. And some of us in this room have reached that age that there's no way that that can happen with you. And you're not that old. The body changes. But Abraham believed God. That's a strong faith that God would take a man as good as dead and a woman whose womb was dead and bring about conception and bring about a child. And look at verse 20. Yet with respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God. How strongly do we believe the promises of God? So that's real easy to give that to Abraham because it happened and we can read about it. How strong is your faith? How strong is my faith? When God says something can be, we're not talking about miracles now. We're just talking about certain things. You remember, one of the things that's good and that we understand about faith, it's an active faith. I do not believe an active faith is a living faith. James talks about it. Faith without works is dead. It doesn't live. And so you read in Philippians 1, verse 21, the Apostle Paul was in prison in Rome, and he wrote a letter to the church at Philippi. He didn't know whether he would live or die. But he said in verse 21, For me to live is Christ. If I stay here, for me to live is Christ. But to die is gain. Paul said, while I'm on this earth, I'm going to live for Christ. If I die, it's a gain. He was ready to accept whatever happened. But faith is active, that it is steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 58. That a dead faith won't do anything for Jesus. Or it'll talk, but it won't do anything. But faith by sight. How about Matthew 14? Know about verses 22 through 31. The disciples were out on a boat in a storm, and here comes Jesus walking on the water. And they were scared. They thought it was a ghost. And Peter said, well, if it's you, Lord, call me to come out to you. Jesus told him to come out. That man got out of that boat and literally walked on water. True or false? He did. But when he looked at the wind and the waves and the storm, he began to sink. Because then he moved from walking by faith to walking by sight. And he began to drown. And he cried out for the Lord to help him, and the Lord saved him. But if he hadn't said anything, he would have died right there if he couldn't swim. I'm hoping a fisherman could swim. No man's going to swim forever. But what did he do? He looked at the storm. What do we do sometimes? We look at the storms. Where is my faith in the storm? Where is your faith in the storms of life? And it's either a strong faith or it's a faith that walks by sight. I've never seen Jesus. I've never seen heaven. And I've never seen a miracle. Somebody says, yeah, no, I have not. Not a Bible miracle, I haven't. I've seen a lot of the providence of God at work. Amen. I've seen the providence at work. But I've never seen a man born blind healed. Jesus did that in John 9, and I believe he did it without question. I believe in John chapter 11, Jesus raised a man named Lazarus from the dead. I believe the gospel accounts that Jesus was resurrected from the grave on the third day. And I believe what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, that he appeared to more than 500 brethren at once. And I believe that when we read the conclusion of Luke's gospel and the beginning of the book of Acts, that Jesus ascended into heaven and he sat down at the right hand of God. Did I see it? No. But I do have some testimony here that tells me about it, and I believe it. But that's easy, really, when we think about applying that word and those and God's promises to everyday life. I want to ask a question to anybody who's listening, especially maybe those on the internet. Where's our faith during COVID? Where are some of God's people? I talk to elders and other preachers all the time and say, Roger, people just aren't coming anymore, and they're not. It's not a COVID problem. No, it's not. It's a heart and faith problem, Brother Larry. Exactly. They're walking by sight. And they're looking at the world. They're not looking up at things above. They're caught up in the here and now. Jesus, by the Apostle Peter in 2 Peter 3 and verse 10, said he's going to burn this world up one of these days. The earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. The elements will melt with fervent heat. There's nothing that will be left. Press on to the goal then of walking by faith. What does that mean to walk by faith and not by sight? It's total, total trust in God. And it's like Abraham. It did not, it does not, it will not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God. Listen to verse 21. And being fully assured that what God had promised, he was also able to perform. And you can say that, well, that's Abraham was just a man. But a man of faith. When God spoke, he believed him. How are we doing in that area? Number three, press on to the goal as a doer of the word and not just a hearer. James 1:17 through 25. And James goes on to say, you know, a man who's a hearer, but he's not a doer, he's like a man who looks in a mirror and he sees himself and he goes away and forgets what manner of man he was. Somebody commented on that and they said they saw a bad man, didn't do anything about it. I'm not sure that they have been right about that. He saw a bad man, but he wouldn't change. Else why use the illustration? Be doers of the word and not hearers only. I have the capacity and have used it to listen to some of these Old Testament prophets for my Sunday evening lessons. I may be out walking in the neighborhood and I'll get my phone and I'll listen to Habakkuk or whatever I'm getting ready to do my lesson on. I may turn and just listen to the Sermon on the Mount or just... And Jesus talked about doing things in the Sermon on the Mount, did he not? So it's great that I heard it, but the question is, did I do anything with it? Did I listen to the Lord? You know, the Word of God is a precious, precious thing. We could talk about the value of God's Word all day long, but the question is, how valuable is it to us? Well, it's God's word from Genesis to Revelation, somebody says. There's not a contradiction in it, absolutely. And it flows, and it has a continuity to it, and it all has that crimson thread of the redemption of Christ from the beginning all the way to the end. And all these 40 different writers over 1,500 years wrote 66 books, and there's no contradictions. Great. But is it having an impact on my life? Facts are fun, but putting these things, listen to the psalmist. In Psalm 119, beginning with the 25th verse, the psalmist says, I am your servant. Give me understanding that I may know your testimonies. It is time for the Lord to act, for they have broken your law. Therefore, I love your commandments above gold, yes, above fine gold. Therefore, I will esteem right all your precepts concerning everything. I hate every false way. The Word of God had an impact on David's life, more precious to him than gold. Now, gold has always been considered an excellent commodity to own because it holds its value and it goes up in value over time. And it's always tradable or sellable. But God's Word is more precious to David than that, because it gives him an understanding. I want to live for you. I don't want to just talk about it, Lord. I want to be blessed by what you have to say. be doers of the word and not hearers only. That was a great sermon, preacher. I've had people tell me that, and in the next week you hear about something they haven't changed in their lives for years, and it was sinful. I don't understand. Why, how can a person stand there and say it was a great message and go out and continue to live in sin because they're hearers and not doers? I have to apply it. It has to change me, to transform my mind. So the next thing is, number four, press on to goal by being supremely committed not only to God's word, but to the church. There is nothing more precious, no institution on this earth more precious than the Lord's church, not even the family. Why, a single person can have a Christian family in the church. Divorced people can have the church as their family. Married people, children, we have a family. And I see family first, family first, family first everywhere. How about God's family first? How about the church that Jesus paid for with his own blood? If God's family is first, that means Jesus is first. And if all that's first, then my family will be well cared for. They will be cared for very well by me. But you know, going back to work, we read in Ephesians 4, verse 16, that the church grows by what every joint supplies. Talking about like a physical body. Brother Larry and I were talking this morning about grandchildren and great-grandchildren and how quickly they grow. I think Clay said little Clark has grown an inch since he was born the 23rd of November. Well, it won't be long till he's grown 3 or 4 inches and he's putting on weight. That's just normal. The body grows. How is little Clark's body doing this? Everything's working right. Everything's contributing to that. It just amazes me. If they could do a scientific explanation of everything that's even going on in my body right now, let's a child that's growing, and those genes, I mean, the cells duplicating themselves, and you know you completely renew yourself every 7 years, don't you? But it's old cells making new cells, so that's why you get old and die. But God caused that to happen. What makes the church grow? Something that's going on inside by every member. There's no such thing as a growing church where people aren't active. The preacher can't do it by himself. You can't do it by yourself, can you? Can we each contribute something? Oh, absolutely. What happens? Paul says, well, when that happens, it grows. We've had a saying for years. Well, the church doesn't need you as much as you need the church. Well, I agree with that. But I also agree that the church needs you. We need the church. We need Christ. We need the church. But the church also needs us. It's a functioning body. On January the 12th, 1912, my granddaddy, H.C. Leonard, worked for 12 hours. He told me that one time, like around 1972. He said, 12, 12, 12, and 12. And I don't know how much he got paid per hour. That always made an impression on me, and I thought, well, what if we worked like that in the church? What if we put forth that kind of effort? I just have remembered that, but we need to be committed to the church. The church has an impact on society that's positive. The best people in the world are members of the body of Christ. That doesn't mean that you're in and of yourself. God makes us better, but the best people in the world are faithful Christians. The most effective people in the world are working faithful Christians. Make an effort to help somebody. While Jesus is on people's minds this time of year, say, well, it's wrong for the church to celebrate Christmas in a religious fashion. I agree. We don't see that in Scripture, but surely we can talk about Jesus to people. I'll do a lesson next Sunday on what we ought to say, what things to think about. The next point, number five, is press on to the goal by striving to save your family. We talked about the family this morning, and it's heartbreaking what the devil has done to families. It is heartbreaking. It's devastating. It's damning. people are going to hell because the devil has shipwrecked the home. And he's, and I don't like to say it this way, but you understand, tongue in cheek, he's done a good job. If you want, I mean, he's been effective. Let me say it that way. The Bible says, and I know we don't live by the Old Testament except by principle. Romans 15:4, those things that were written before time were written for our learning. Psalm 127:1, unless the Lord builds a house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord's building your house, you are wasting your time. I'm wasting mine. And then he goes on to say in verse 3, behold, children are a gift of the Lord. Isn't that precious? The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Picture a warrior with all of his arrows, and he's gone out to battle, and he's using those to hunt or defend himself, to fend off evil, and really that's the picture. The quiver is full of them. They will not be ashamed when they speak with their enemies in the gate. What are you talking about here, Solomon? One of the few psalms that Solomon wrote. What are you talking about? I'm talking about when the Lord builds the house and you look at your children as a heritage or a blessing or a gift from God, the fruit of the womb being a reward from God, then you train those children, as Paul would say in Ephesians 6:4, in the training of the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, and they go out to confront their enemies, they're prepared. They're prepared to deal with what comes at them. Because his arrow, his quiver is full, but then the children will not be ashamed, verse 5, when they speak with their enemies in the gate. Why? They've been taught. They've been prepared. We have an obligation to make sure that we try and teach our children. Somebody says, well, my children are all grown. Well, you have grandchildren. You have great-grandchildren. You have time with them. Feed them a little bit of God's word. John would say in 2 John 4, I was very glad to find some of your children walking in truth, just as we have received commandment to do from the Father. I know John was talking, like as an elder, about his spiritual children in the church, but the principle's still true. That I was glad to find that some of my children were walking in truth. I picked up a book about 21 years ago, something that effect, by Chuck Colson, who was once a presidential advisor, I believe, to Richard Nixon. And on page 142, he talks about moral resistance. I'm sorry, page 184, he talks about beginning at home. Listen to this. A few years ago, 9-year-old Jeffrey Bailey Jr., 9-year-old now, calmly pushed a 3-year-old child into the deep end of a swimming pool. Like a scientist making a detached observation, Jeffrey pulled up a lawn chair and sat down to watch the younger child drown. When the police tracked down the young killer, he was nonchalant and even seemed to enjoy all the attention. Now, why do these things happen? Chuck Colson was pretty sharp. He said, this chilling story is told in High Risk by psychologist Ken Magid. Magid describes children who have little sense of right and wrong, no conscience. At core, crime is a moral problem, and it requires a moral solution. Yes, ultimately, it depends on the cultivation of the conscience, because the conscience is training. The most chilling stories in the news today are about kids who kill with no glimmer of conscience, like young Jeffrey Bailey. This utter inattention from normal human emotions has been traced to a breakdown in parent-child relationships. That's it. When children do not have a relationship with their parents and they're not taught anything, they have no conscience. It all comes back to a rebellion against the will of God, and so I have an obligation as a father. I'm not going to be the perfect father. Haven't been, never will be, but I need to try to be the best I can, a grandfather, And by the way, I still have four living children, and I'm still their daddy. And I have an obligation. I watched a video recently a man had made about some people in some Appalachian area, I think in West Virginia. And he interviewed this family, and there was a man there who probably was in his 50s. And he had a strange look on his face, and he couldn't talk. He could just bark like a dog. Now, how do you think that happened? I'll tell you, something didn't happen. And I found out there was some inbreeding, if you know what that is. You know, there's some incest going on there. You know, that go. Anytime you go against God's will, you're going to get strange results. But a person can have a certain innate ability to talk, but they really can't learn to speak and speak well and think and have a conscience unless they're taught and trained. We have an obligation in God's family to make sure that our children or grandchildren or anybody we have an influence on to change the way they think. You can't change the world, but you can change one child at a time. One of our evangelists, Jimmy Allen, passed not too long ago, and one of the more powerful preachers in our brotherhood. Jimmy was relating a story recently how that he was not raised, he was born out of wedlock. Wasn't sure his father was, but his mother raised him. And he said, but I fought the devil for a long time, and I did what I wanted to for a long time, and I was good at cards, and I was good at all this. And he says, but you know, somebody took the time to teach me the gospel, and I changed. He said, but it was my godly mother that got it all started. And you think about the power of the home. Don't you ever give up. I could go on with this for 3 days. I won't. But don't ever give up. And don't you give in to the ways of the world. And don't compromise, even for your own children. If it's wrong, it's wrong. Take God's word and tell them. Because nobody else probably is going to. You know, in 2 Timothy 3 and verse 15, you know, verse 16, but in verse 15, Paul would tell young Timothy that from childhood you have known the sacred scriptures which are able to make you wise for salvation. His mother and his grandmother Lois taught him. His father, according to Acts 16, was a Greek. He probably believed in the Greek gods, but his mother took him to the word. And look what Timothy did. He became a gospel preacher. And even if he didn't, he could have been a faithful child of God. Every family must be engaged in training at home, and to the best of your ability, get your children involved in the Lord's work. I have to tell you that Brother Bill Ward was excellent at that. He made his children work for Jesus, and he did a good job of it. As far as I know, they're still faithful. It can be done. Teach us all to be like Isaiah. Grandfather, great-grandfather, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, cousin, aunt, uncle, fellow member of the church, somebody who has friends, be like Isaiah, Isaiah 6:8. Lord, here am I. Send me. Lord, here am I. Use me. Because there's an upward call that God has given, and it's far above any and everything on this earth. And Paul had that upward call when you read Philippians chapter 3, beginning with verse 12. Paul had been talking about resurrection from the dead in verse 11. He says, not that I have attained already or have already become perfect, but what do? Title for our lesson, I press on. I press on that I may lay hold of that for which I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. Brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press onward to the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. There's the answer to the problem in the church of people who have just quit on Jesus. That's why our buildings are empty. they hadn't quit necessarily on the church. They've quit on God. They've quit on the Lord. If I'm following Jesus, I'll go anywhere he wants me to. I'll be anywhere he wants me to be. I'll do anything he wants me to do. But I have an upward call. This call didn't come from earth, did it, Paul? It's the upward call, the upward call, the upward call of God. And I want to add this to it in your home. Make your home strong. Let's make the church strong. Ephesians 4:12. And if a man prevail against him that is alone, two shall withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Pull together. Strengthen one another. Warren Buffett is one of the wealthiest men in the world. I'm assuming he's in his 80s. But at age 11, he started learning how to buy and sell stocks. And he's good at it. And the reason I bring him up is that one of his rules for investing is putting his investing in a company that he knows is stable, that provides good returns, and one that he can stay with for a long time. Well, that's wise. How can we apply this? Can you think of anything worth more than the church to invest in? Can you think of anything worth more than your own soul to invest in? Can you think of anything worth more than the souls of your family or the people that we know to invest in? I can't. I think, let's press onward. Let's press onward. And I know I've gone over time, but I'm going to have to put this in here. I don't care what anybody else does. I'm going to do it. I'm not going to quit on the Lord. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound. I'm headed for heaven. Now, how about you this morning? What are your goals? What's your number one goal? Become a Christian, one must believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God without doubt. Must be willing to make Christ his or her Lord. Anything and everything Jesus wants them to do. They must confess him before men that he's the Son of God. They must be baptized for the remission of their sins, to have their sins washed away by his precious blood. The scripture backs all those things up. And also for those who may be listening or anyone here who's not faithful to their Lord, it's time to come home and press on for the upward way and forget about the ways of the world, because the ways of the world will end up in spiritual death and destruction. If you need to come, please do so as we stand and say.
Wonderful story of love, tell it to me again. Wonderful story of love. Wake the immortal strain, angels with rapture announce it, shepherds with wonder receive it, sinner, oh, won't you believe it, wonderful story of love, wonderful,
wonderful.
752. After this, we will observe the Lord's Supper. 752.
When my love to Christ grows weak, when for deeper faith I seek, then in thought I go to thee, Garden of Gethsemane. There I walk amid the shades, while the
gather together on the first day of the week. We worship and we glorify our Father in heaven. And I can't think of a better way to start my week. We also set apart time to remember the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When we read our scriptures, we read that Jesus, he knew he was about to die, and he gathered about him his 12 disciples and he shared the Last Supper with them. This morning, we'll read our scripture from the book of Mark, and we'll start with chapter 14, and we'll read about the Lord's Supper. We'll start at verse 22. And as they were eating, Jesus, he took bread, he blessed and he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And then he took the cup, when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it, and he said to them, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. Assuredly, I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." We'll ask Brother Tony to say a prayer for the bread.
Dear God, Lord, we're so thankful so much for what Jesus did for us. And we pray, Heavenly Father, as we partake of this bread, Heavenly Father, which is symbolic of his body, that we will think what Jesus went through and go to the cross, dear God, at this time. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Our dear Father in heaven, we would ask a blessing on this cup, Father, the fruit of the vine, which represents the blood that your Son shed on the cross, that we may have eternal life with you in heaven, Father. We are very thankful. We pray this in your Son's name, in Jesus Christ, amen. Now, separate and apart from the Lord's Supper is our opportunity to give back a portion. For it doesn't matter how much we give, we can never outgive the Lord. So this morning we're going to take our scripture and we're going to read from 2 Corinthians. We're going to start at chapter 9 and we'll read from verse 6. But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we're so thankful for all that you have given us, Father. And now it is our opportunity to give back our portion. Dear Father, we pray that we use all these funds to further your kingdom here on earth, Father. We pray this in your Son's name, in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank Roger for that lesson today. I know that it's a good lesson for us to hear, to press upward to the calling. I know I enjoyed it. I know everybody here did to help encourage us to be better as we leave. If there's nothing further, remember the service is at 5 o'clock this afternoon. And bow with me. We'll have a closing prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, dear God, for your word. We're thankful, dear God, for the lesson that we heard. We're thankful, dear God, for the work that Roger does here, and we're thankful, dear God, for the knowledge and the study that he does. We pray, Heavenly Father, as we leave this building this week, as we go to our places in life and work, that we will think and meditate on your word, dear God, and know that what we can do is set our affections on you, dear God, and not worry so much about what's going on here, but to work to have the thought to be with you and to do your will and lead others to you. We know, Heavenly Father, there's on the sick and prayer list that need prayers, and we know, Heavenly Father, that you look down upon them. We pray, Heavenly Father, that most especially that you will look down on Brother Lossie at this time and be with him as he has this trouble up until he gets to see the doctors, that you'll be with him. And we pray, dear God, that something can be done if it's in accordance with your will. We're thankful, dear God, for all the wonderful blessings that you give us. We can't count them enough, dear God, for all the love that you show us through your blessings. We're thankful, dear God, for Jesus and the blood that he shed for us, dear God, so we can have the forgiveness of our sins. We're so thankful, Father in heaven, that we study your scriptures, and we pray that you'll help us to be encouraged to study more, dear God, so that we can let our light shine even brighter. We're thankful, dear God, for the church that meets here and the churches the world over. We pray, dear God, that things will be done, dear God, for the increase of the teaching, and that things will look better than they have in the past, dear God, through this year. We know, Heavenly Father, that things have been rough through the COVID, but we also know, dear God, that you're in total charge of everything. And we pray, dear God, that we'll put our faith in you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.